The early days of the church were very turbulent ones for the apostles of Christ and the early Christians. The apostles had been with the Lord for 3 years. They had spent that period of time with him, being able to listen to his marvelous teaching. And they also saw him heal the sick. They saw him exercise power over nature. And they saw it raise the dead. They came to the conclusion that he was, in fact, the Messiah. When Jesus asked them the question in Matthew chapter 16, "Whom do you say that I am?" Peter replied, "Thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God." So they knew who Jesus was. And they were very discouraged over the events that led to Calvary. As a matter of fact, their despair is seen following the death of Jesus in the statement that is recorded in Luke chapter 24, verse 21, "We had hoped that it was he that should have redeemed Israel." And at that point, all hope seemed to be lost. They walked away from the cross in despair. But then what a profound difference just a few weeks later made. When Jesus arose from the dead on the third day, they knew that he was in fact the promised Messiah of Israel. And then a few weeks later, on the first Pentecost, following his resurrection, they began to preach his gospel as had been directed by him in the Great Commission. And during this time, there was absolutely no fear. Earlier, they followed him afar off, or they had denied even knowing him. But now there's no fear. Now they stand up before thousands of people, boldly and courageously preaching that he is the Christ, the Son of the living God. 3,000 people on that first day obeyed the gospel of Christ. And then it begins. You go to the next chapter, in chapter 3, Peter and John are about to go into the temple, and they encounter a lame man there at the entrance to the temple. And as Peter and John are about to go in, Peter looks at him and he tells him, "Look at us." The scripture then says that the lame man looked upon them, expecting to receive something from them, a way of alms. Peter then says, "We have no silver and gold, but what we have we give unto you. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk." Peter takes him by the hand and he lifts him up. The man is able to walk. Peter then uses that opportunity to preach Jesus to the Jews, many of whom had been guilty of his crucifixion. They'd been guilty of calling out for him to be crucified. And in verse 17, Peter says, "I know that through ignorance you did it, as did also your rulers." And you go over into chapter 4. And we find that in the city of Jerusalem, the number of the disciples is continuing to grow. People are obeying the gospel by great numbers. As a matter of fact, 5,000 men are counted in Acts 4. Now you combine that with 3,000 on Pentecost, and already the members of the Lord's church are counted as in excess of 8,000 members. And their influence, the influence of the apostles, is continuing to grow. And those who are able to see them and hear them, are able to hear them speak with boldness and see the power that they are exerting by the Holy Spirit. The religious leaders are beginning to be alarmed. And so then, seeking to diminish the influence of the apostles, the council has Peter and John arrested. And it was then that Peter begins to speak to them, and he lets them know in no uncertain terms that what they had just done by healing the lame man was by the authority and the power of Jesus Christ. It was not by their own power. It was not by their own will, but according to the Lord's will. And so the religious leaders are alarmed at what they're seeing. And then we read of those leaders in verse 13 that when they saw the boldness of Peter and John and perceived that they were unlearned and ignorant men, they marveled. The Jewish council, they were amazed. And they took knowledge of them that they had been with Jesus. You see, unlike the Jewish council, the apostles of Christ were uneducated men. And yet, these uneducated men were able to confound the doctors of the law. And these men couldn't understand that. And so the only conclusion that they could come to was, they'd been with Jesus. You know, there's some statements in Scripture that seem to just jump out at you. And that's one of them. They had been with Jesus. They made a profound difference in the early church. God was using them in powerful ways. And not just them, but we also see that the early Christians went out away from Jerusalem in Acts chapter 8, spreading the gospel of Christ. And so in the regions round about, people were obeying the gospel. They had been with Jesus, the apostles. But let me tell you, that principle is still at work in Christians today. By what we're able to do, by the will of God, and by Him using us, in a very real sense, it's because we've been with Jesus. No, not physically, as they were. But for the next few moments, we're going to use this phrase that we've been with Jesus. Not physically, but in the sense that we've been affected by His teachings and by His influence that we can read about in the New Testament. Let's think about this for the next few moments. First of all, Christianity means being with Jesus. In order for one to become a child of God, then that individual must be united with Christ. There's no other way. Paul writes to the Galatians in Galatians chapter 3, verses 26 and 27, "For ye are all the children of God by faith in Christ Jesus. For as many of you as have been baptized into Christ have put on Christ." Now you'll note there the connection with 26 and 27. They became children of God by being baptized into Christ. That is how they put on Christ. And so then, unless one is in Christ, he's not a child of God. But to enter into Christ, to become a child of God, one must be united with Christ. Paul writes about that process in Romans chapter 6, starting with verse 3. "Know ye not that so many of us as were baptized into Jesus Christ were baptized into His death? Therefore we are buried with Him by baptism into death. The like as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we also should walk in newness of life. For if we have been united together in the likeness of His death, we shall be also in the likeness of His resurrection. Knowing this, that our old man is crucified with Him, that the body of sin might be destroyed, that henceforth we should not serve sin. For he that is dead, dead to sin, is freed from sin." And so, the process then is very clear as to how one becomes united with Christ. That's how those on Pentecost became children of God. Peter instructed them, "Repent and be baptized, every one of you in the name of Christ for the remission of sins. Acts 2:38. That's how one becomes a child of God. But then we must also study the life of Christ. And it is so exhilarating to be able to read and to study about the Lord's work during the time that he was here upon this earth. Peter admonishes in 1 Peter 2:21, "For even hereunto were ye called, because Christ also suffered for us, leaving us an example that ye should follow his steps." In order to be followers of Christ, we must study his teachings. We must have the determination to apply what he taught to our lives. And we must have the determination that as we read and study about the things that he did by way of serving as an example to others, we have to have the determination to set the same kind of example before others. Peter told Cornelius in Acts 10:38, Jesus went about doing good. And those who are his followers, those who are his disciples, must do exactly the same thing. We must be conscious of those around us. And we must understand that there are people all around us who have needs. And we must strive to meet those needs, to help people, to do good to others. Paul instructed in Galatians 6:10, as we have opportunity, let us do good unto all men, especially unto those who are the household of faith. The apostles of Christ knew that the life of Jesus was a life of unselfish service. And the Lord, to illustrate this and to show the power of example, told them the parable of the Good Samaritan in Luke 10:30. A certain man went down from Jerusalem to Jericho and fell among thieves, which stripped him of his raiment and wounded him, and departed, leaving him half dead. There came down a priest and a Levite, and both those men who knew the law and were supposed to be practitioners of the law looked upon the man and then passed by on the other side. But there came down a certain Samaritan that way, one who was considered by the Jews to be a half-breed, one who was despised, one who was hated. That man, when he came to the wounded man, saw that he had a need. And the Lord said he had compassion on him, and went to him and bound up his wounds, pouring it all in wine, and put him on his beast, and took him to the inn and took care of him. A life of service. That was the lesson. And those who follow the Lord must also strive to live a life of service. The Lord was not seeking world renown. He was not seeking social approval. He was not seeking wealth. But the one thing that he had in the forefront of his mind throughout his time here upon this earth is stated by him in John 4, in verse 34. The Lord said, "My meat," or my sustenance, "is to do the will of him that sent me and to accomplish his work." That's John 4. You go two chapters over, John 6:38. Jesus says, "I came down from heaven not to do my own will, but the will of him that sent me." And those who have been with Jesus will seek to do the same thing. They will seek to do the will of God. They will seek to practice New Testament Christianity. They will seek to let others know by word and example that we're not Christians in name only. That it's not something that we simply profess to be. But Christian is who we are. We are of Christ. We are followers of Christ. We're his people. And so then we follow in his steps. Christianity then means being with Jesus. But then in the second place, Christian character means being with Jesus. Christian character. Just before his arrest, Jesus was in Gethsemane praying to the Father. And he prayed in Luke 22:42, "Father, if it be thy will, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but thine be done. Can you imagine the commitment and the courage that it took to pray that prayer? Father, if it be possible, let this hour pass from me. But not my will, but your will be done. But that was more than just a prayer, wasn't it? That was the way that he lived. That characterized the entirety of the Lord's life here upon this earth, to do the will of God. Those who were his followers sought to do the same thing. The Apostle Paul, formerly known as Saul of Tarsus, was a persecutor of the church before his conversion to Christ. And he did everything probably humanly possible to stamp out Christianity, to destroy that movement, to destroy the followers of Jesus Christ. And then on the road to Damascus in Acts chapter 9, everything changed. He met the Lord. The Lord identified himself, and he told him what he needed to do. And Paul, even though he was blind, was led by the hand into the city. And it was there that Ananias told him, "Arise and be baptized and wash away thy sins, calling on the name of the Lord." Acts 22 and 16. And then following his conversion, following his baptism, even more changed. He became a servant of Christ. As a matter of fact, we read that immediately he began to preach in the synagogues that Jesus is the Christ. Oh, what a change. Saul, the persecutor, became Paul, the persecuted. And in Ephesians chapter 6 and verse 10, Paul was writing to his Ephesian brethren, and he said, "Be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might." It was so necessary and is necessary today that every follower of Christ be strong. And in the context of chapter 6 and verse 10, Paul mentions the different parts of the Christian armor: the shield of faith, the breastplate of righteousness, the helmet of salvation, the sword of the Spirit, feet shod with preparation of the gospel of peace. All of those parts of the Christian armor add to the Christian's strength. Paul summed up his life in Philippians chapter 4, verses 11 and 13. In verse 11 he says, "I have learned that in whatsoever state I am, therewith to be content." Did you catch that? "I've learned in whatever state I'm in, therewith to be content." Those weren't just words. That's what he practiced. And in 2 Corinthians, you see that in chapter 12. He had a thorn in the flesh, and he begged the Lord to remove it. And the Lord refused to do so, saying, "My grace is sufficient for thee." So, did Paul learn contentment? You better believe it. Paul said, "Most gladly, therefore, will I rather glory in my infirmities, that the power of Christ may rest upon me. Therefore, I take pleasure in infirmities, in necessities, in reproaches, in persecutions for Christ's sake. For when I am weak, then am I strong." Yes, he learned contentment. Then he said in verse 13 of Philippians 4, "I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me, with or without a thorn in the flesh." Because he recognized that Jesus Christ was the source of his strength. He realized that Jesus Christ is what he needed, is whom he needed. And he followed Christ in every aspect of his life. He strived to imitate Christ. We read that Jesus served others during his time here upon this earth. Paul often identified himself as a servant of Jesus Christ. Well, there's no wonder, because he strived to follow his master and to be just like his master. In Matthew 20 and 28, Jesus said, "For even as the Son of Man came not to be ministered unto, but to minister, and to give his life a ransom for many." And Jesus gave the example. He gave the lesson to his apostles. In John chapter 13, he took out a wash basin, filled it with water, and took a towel and girded himself with it and began to wash the disciples' feet. And then following that, he says, I've given you an example that you should do unto others as I have done unto you. What did he do? He gave them an example of service. Serve others. Because I've served you. But then finally, Christian concern means being with Jesus. Christian concern. What was the purpose for which Jesus came into the world? Those who've been with Jesus know the answer to that. The angel announced to Joseph in Matthew 1 and verse 21, you shall call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sins. Jesus said in Luke 19 and 10, for the Son of Man has come to seek and to save that which was lost. Jesus lived for, worked for, died for the forgiveness, even of those who nailed him to the cross. Mankind was lost and dying in sin. Sin was the great plague that had been upon mankind since the dawn of creation. Sin separates one from God, Isaiah 59 and 2. Sin brings spiritual death, Ezekiel 18 and 20, Romans 6, 23. Man needed a Savior. And so Christ went to the cross. Forgiveness was the reason he went to the cross, to make it available to all men. And there on the cross, suspended between heaven and earth, Jesus prayed in Luke 23 and 34, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Forgiveness was offered. And about 50 days or so later, on the first Pentecost following his resurrection, they had the opportunity to respond to the grace of God. And when they complied with the requirements set forth by the inspired apostles of Christ, they obtained the remission of sins. Forgiveness, then, is what the Lord had in mind. Those who have been with Jesus also seek to have a forgiving spirit, a forgiving attitude. In Ephesians 4 and verse 32, Paul said, and be ye kind one to another, tenderhearted, forgiving one another, even as God for Christ's sake hath forgiven you. And so that's the attitude that you and I need to have. Jesus was willing for those who spat upon him and nailed him to the cross and beat him. He was willing for them to be forgiven and desired that they be forgiven. We have to have the same attitude. And if we're going to be followers of Christ, disciples of Christ, then that's the attitude that we'll have. Jesus stated the price of discipleship in Matthew 16 and 24. If any man will come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. Self-denial, self-sacrifice is the price of following the Lord. That's the price of being a disciple of Christ. Jesus himself set the example. He is our Savior, but not only our Savior, he is our master. He is our teacher. And that's what he taught us. The Lord was committed. He was committed to the mission that brought him into the world. He was committed to the purpose that took him to the cross. Paul writes in 2 Corinthians 5 and 15 that Jesus died for all, that they which live should not henceforth live unto themselves, but unto him which died for them and rose again. Jesus died on the cross to provide us with the ability and the necessity of making a decision to be committed to him and to be committed to the purpose that took him to the cross, to live for him, to please him every day that we live here in this life. Paul wrote of his own commitment in Galatians chapter 2 and verse 20. And you see the drastic change that came about in Paul's life once he was converted to Christ. Before, he was a persecutor. He was injurious to the church. He did violent action to the church. And that's what he's writing to Timothy about in 1 Timothy chapter 1. But he says he did it ignorantly. It was still sinful, but he did it ignorantly. But then once he was converted to Christ, he worked tirelessly for the cause of Christ. He wasn't concerned for his own life. He told his brethren, "I don't count my life dear unto myself." He was only interested in pleasing the Lord and doing the work that the Lord had commissioned him to do. He was committed. And he also served as an example to others. In Galatians 2 and verse 20, he said, "I've been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I that live, but Christ lives in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me." Christ lives in me. That was his life. Christ lives in me. And every follower of Christ, all those who have been with Jesus, should be able to say the same thing. Christ lives in me. And so we turn this around and we look inwardly. I say that Jesus was committed to his mission, his purpose for coming into the world. We see that the apostles were committed to the work that he gave them to do. We see that Paul, also an apostle, was committed to Christ. So what about our own commitment? Well, we read in Romans 12 and verse 1, for Paul says, "I beseech you therefore by the mercies of God that ye present your bodies a living sacrifice." There was the offering of animal sacrifices back under the Old Testament system, the Levitical system. The Lord doesn't require that today. He doesn't require us to offer sacrifices on altars that have been erected for that purpose, nor does he require us as individuals to lie down on an altar of sacrifice and to give ourselves in that way. But he does require a living sacrifice. Paul summed it up when he said, "I live by the faith of the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me." That should sum up our lives as well. We live by the faith of the Son of God who loved us and gave himself for us. They had been with Jesus. And what a profound effect they had on the first century church. So much so that by the time you get down to Acts chapter 17 and verse 6, and by the way, these words were not intended to be complimentary to first century Christians. Oh, but they were true. It was said of the church in Acts 17 and verse 6, "These that have turned the world upside down have come here also." They turned the world upside down for Christ. Why? Because they had been with Jesus. And he had a profound effect in their life. And yes, as they began their work, the Holy Spirit came upon them in Acts chapter 2, empowering them to work miracles to confirm the word that they were preaching, inspiring them so that whatever and wherever they were preaching the word of God, that it was in fact the word of God. But they made a profound effect. We can today as well. We have to have the same determination that they had. There may be someone here who's not a Christian, and we encourage you to obey the gospel of Jesus Christ. Peter again instructed those in Acts 2, 38, "Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Christ, for the remission of sins." That's what's required today. One must be united with Christ in the waters of baptism. If you're an unfaithful child of God, return to your first love. Rededicate your life to him and his purpose for your life. So let us strive to live our lives and work in a way that we also have a profound effect upon the community in which we live. are subject to heaven's invitation.